Good evening, everyone. I, Gauri Ranjan, a second-year undergraduate student of Manav Rachna, will be presenting the topic Methods for Gender Identification in Forensic Odontology. As we all know, forensic odontology is a scientific discipline that has been created by the integration of criminal sciences into dentistry. Since gender is an important aspect of a person's identity, there are various methods in forensic dentistry that can be used to determine the same. No two mouths are alike. This concept is extremely similar in nature to the unique existence of fingerprints. The added advantage that dentistry has in forensic analysis is that tooth enamel is the hardest tissue in the body, and because of its hardness and high resistivity to degradation and putrefaction, it manages to not only remain intact after death, but also retains many of its properties even in the face of fire and bacterial decomposition. Now, the methods can be divided under three categories, which can be visual, microscopic, or advanced. Under visual methods, we can see differences in tooth size, which measures mesiodistal and buccolingual dimensions to figure out the dissimilarities. It is often observed that mandibular canines show the greatest dimensional difference with large teeth in males than in females. The next essential subcategory under visual methods would be canine dimorphism, which basically includes analysis of dimensions of canine teeth by various methods such as Fourier analysis, Moray topography, studies conducted by Anderson and Thompson. All these studies conclude that the mandibular canine showed a greater degree of sexual dimorphism, and the width of mandibular canine along with the intercanine distance was also greater in males. Dental index, which is the next subcategory, uses tooth proportions for differentiating between the sexes. Mandibular canine index explains a formula that gives a value of 7.1, which basically means that 7.1 millimeter is the maximum possible mesiodistal dimension of mandibular canines in females, whereas the same dimensions are greater in males. When talking about the final subcategory, odontometric differences, it can easily be explained by the fact that there is a greater genetic expression in males than females. The next major category would be microscopic methods, under which falls the use of bar bodies. Now, bar bodies are basically inactive ex-chromatin, and many researchers use either necrotic or dehydrated pulp tissues for the presence of Y chromosomes in the case of maleness, and even claim that an accurate determination can be made even after several weeks of death along with exposure to high temperatures. Now I'll talk about the advanced methods under which determination can be done either by using PCR or enamel protein. Since PCR amplifies DNA target sequences, it is quite obvious that the method can be used for gender identification. Short sequences of DNA can be extracted from dental pulp and then amplified using PCR, which can be subsequently analyzed for the presence of sex chromosomes. When using enamel protein, the presence and location of amelogenin gene is analyzed and gender can be determined in the case of females who will have two identical amelogenin genes, whereas the males will have two different genes. When talking about the extent of accuracy that visual methods exhibit, a precision of 80% is recorded when using measurements of root length and crown diameters for the gender determination, whereas canine dimorphism accounts to a success rate of 74%. However, the highest success rate of 89% is observed when dental index is used for the purpose. The methods that can give a success rate of 100% fall under the category of advanced. I'd like to conclude by stating that the methods for gender identification of forensic odontology can be excellently used in cases wherein only skeletal fragments of the body are available. Thank you.